Hello, I'm Lexie.
And I'm Meg.
And welcome to Script in Hand, the podcast where two friends and theatre directors delve into plays and talk text. It's the last one of season one.
Sad times. But we'll be back, so it's fine.
We'll be back, bitches.
Yes.
I was trying to do a term. I was thinking Terminator in my head when I did that, but that wasn't at all from a. I really misjudged that.
If you tried.
Anyway, Meg, what are we doing for our final episode of season one?
We are doing Emilia by Morgan Lloyd Malcolm.
Yay! And wow, what a play! And Emilia was published by Oberon Modern Plays.
It was first performed at the Globe Theatre in August 2018, and then it transferred to the Vaudeville Theatre in 2019. So again, it's a pretty recent one.
We are so down with the current times. We're so hip. We're hip with our play knowledge. We know what's out and what's fresh. I don't think me saying fresh makes it fresh, does it?
Oh, that's funny.
Emilia was nominated for Olivier Awards for the Best Comedy, Best Costume and Best Set Design for its Vaudeville production. And those awards are all pending due to COVID, so we don't know the results yet. It was also nominated for 2 Mousetrap Awards for Best Play and, get this category, Power of the Ensemble.
Ooh, yes. That is a nice category. So Emilia is about Emilia Bassano, who is believed to be the Dark Lady of Shakespeare's sonnets. But it's not about Shakespeare. This is about Emilia. And you have 3 actors playing Emilia at her different ages. And it just kind of follows her story and highlights her voice, which it's just amazing.
And as the Michael Billington Guardian review said, precisely because the known facts are so few about Emilia, Morgan Lloyd Malcolm is free to invent, and in a play that rouses its audience to a pitch of fervour, turns it into a symbol of women down the ages who have struggled to make their voices heard.
Oh, isn't that just what we need?
Hear, hear.
So there's a note on the text at the beginning of the play as well, which I absolutely love. So it says, "This play was written to be performed by an all-female cast of diverse women. It would not be the same play if this is ignored. If being performed in school where it is impossible to adhere to this, then please cast against the usual type. Be bold."
Love it.
I literally, it gives me goosebumps when I read that. I was like, oh my god, we are in for a ride. I knew before I even picked up this play, I was like, this is going to be one of my favourites, and it did not disappoint.
No, it lights the proverbial fire under your ass as a reader.
Oh my god, yeah.
Can't imagine what it's like seeing it live. Oh!
I couldn't cope.
Adding it to our list of wings we wish we could time travel to see.
I have always, there's 2 productions in my entire life that I will hate myself and never see in, and this is one of them. The other one's Imogen, which was also at the Globe, so maybe I should just go to the Globe more. Oh god, I would give anything to go back in time and see this.
So a little bit about Morgan Lloyd Malcolm. Morgan's play Belongings was produced at the Hampstead Theatre and Trafalgar Studios in 2011 to great acclaim and was shortly listed for the Charles Winter Most Promising Playwright Award. This was followed in 2015 by another hit play, The Wasp, which also transferred to the Trafalgar Studios. And she was commissioned by the Globe itself to write Emilia, which became a sellout hit in Somerset in 2018 and then, as you say, transferred to the Vaudeville. Other stage works include commissions for The Old Vic, Clean Break and Firehouse Productions. And in 2013, she was chosen as a member of the Soho Six. And she's written several pantomimes and large community plays as well for The Old Vic, New Voices, Platform and Epidemic.
Amazing. Yeah, that's sick.
And we are joined by a special guest for today's episode.
We are.
Our final special guest of the season. We are being joined by theatre director Beck Gadsby, who is not only a really great friend to me and Meg, but is an amazing.
Amelia amazing. That kind of worked. You kind of mixed in Amelia with amazing there. I liked that.
I did, subconscious. She is an ameliorizing theatre director and super fan of Emilia. So Rebeccca Gadsby specialises in period dramas, classics and comedy. She has built a reputation for creating shows that require a big imagination and has created work for mid-scale theatres, international touring and studio theatre. She's done a national tour of Pride and Prejudice, Sense and Sensibility, and she's currently the creator and artistic director of Digital Midsummer, which is a new theatre app to be released in September. So that's super exciting. We'll put all the links to Beck and to Digital Midsummer in our episode bio. Do check her out. She's fabulous. Oh, you know what I love about this script? I think we can say this now. It includes, guys, there's bonus material.
Yes!
It includes Emilia Sardo Lanier's poems.
Yeah, so she was a poet, and that's kind of how her, in quote marks, relationship with Shakespeare kind of came from. Yeah, so it includes her poems, which is just amazing.
And it's a story where I love in Morgan and Lloyd Malcolm's like notes, she references our Emilia. So she's reclaiming her for women, not the male historians who've given their take on her. And in the past, it's reclaiming her for women by a women writer, women direct, women-led artistic director at the Globe. Female empowerment, rawr!
Yes!
So, without further ado, shall we welcome Beck and talk about Emilia?
Let's go!
So, Beck, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for inviting me.
To talk about this amazing play.
Yes, one of the best.
What a piece. And Meg and I were just talking just in the intro about how it is a play that Morgan Lloyd Malcolm has said has to be performed by an all-female diverse cast. I think that is so, A, friggin' incredible. It's brilliant. And I was just wondering what you think it means, given that half the characters are obviously male characters, what it does to the text in terms of females playing these male characters. Because we could totally tell the story of Emilia with male actors in it playing these male roles. But it does something really interesting to it, with it all being females and these extravagant moustaches and headpieces and the like.
Yeah, I think to start with, I mean, the comedy factor of seeing, you know, women dressed up playing these male roles, because for so long we have seen men dressing up, sending up women in panto and that sort of tradition we've had for ages. But it is really nice. But also, because this is a play about a woman's story and a woman's journey, it's really nice. And by that, I mean sort of not just Emilia's story, but the way the play cleverly opens it out is that it's sort of every woman's story as well. And I think what I really like about the women playing men is that it's from our perspective, and men portray themselves so very differently. And I think they think we perceive them in a particular way. But actually, when you start having women playing those men's parts, you go, oh, okay. Hopefully, at least, the men might go, wait a second, that's how you think of us? And then we can go, yeah, guys, that's what you look like to us when you do that. Yeah, well, you think you're really cool and you come up and you know, say something highly amusing at the bar. Actually, what we think is, what a dick. And that's what I think this, by having the women play those male roles, I think it just so effortlessly communicates that message.
It amplifies the comedy in it, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
It is such a funny play, though, Meg, you're right. The language in it, I love how she uses like a combination of classical language and then modern day language to kind of really get those laughs and also get the banter out of it. So there's that bit where she, Emilia goes to like basically finishing school essentially for how to be a lady, and the lady running it, Susan Birch, says, practical assessment, Lady Catherine, hanky drop. I'm like, yes, because that's just like the bend and snap. And it's, I can imagine that so clearly in my head.
It's really interesting how she brings in those cultural references but kind of makes them Elizabethan at the same time. It's really interesting.
And maybe they were always Elizabethan.
Well, yeah, that's the thing. They were always there, just never told. and before they do the dance as well, she says, are you ready to slay?
Which is just such a brilliant line and such a big build-up to that moment as well in the play, where she's kind of under this sort of societal pressure to conform and be on display as a woman. Mm. And look, you're going to have to show your wares. And it's kind of like, it reminds me a little bit of the cattle market almost. Like, and kind of building to that moment is that sort of pressure of, look, you've got to be on display at court, and you're going to have to dance, and you're going to have to do all of these things and conform in this way. And you can see that pressure building on Emilia, going, I just don't want to be portrayed in that way. I don't want to be sold off like a piece of meat. And what a great line, just because you're building up in that very traditional sort of view of thinking, oh yeah, this is how it was for women. And then suddenly she comes out with that line, are we ready to slay? Which is just brilliant.
What was the atmosphere like when she said that in the room? Because it's not where you expect that line to go. Does everyone just go, yes? I just imagine there'd be a lot of clicking of fingers.
Just a lot of laughing. Well, it kind of goes straight into, as I remember, it went straight into a movement sequence anyway, and some choreography, which was kind of this sort of blend of Elizabethan with modern day, which was just fantastic. It was fabulous. So, yeah, it was kind of a big blend of those two things. So, I mean, it was just a big raucous laughter moment in the audience.
I love it. I love what she says about becoming a woman, like at the very top of the play when she's still in Emilia 1 version. She says, I can be tamed. I know now that as I grow, I must also shrink. I must not take up too much space. And if I am to marry well, and I need to practice these tricks to hush my whole being so that I can only be seen when needed. Mm. I'm like, ugh.
Brings it home a bit, doesn't it? Yeah.
Mm. I love that. Because as I grow, I must also shrink. It's such clear and beautiful language and imagery used.
And just something that just hits with every woman as well, right? When you hear that, it's that notion when you sit on the tube and the bloke sits with his legs spread wide apart and you kind of have to push yourself and make yourself smaller, and how we're trying to be smaller, fit in smaller dresses, have a more fragile frame. And I think it relates to so much in so many different cultures about how women have to be tinier and smaller. And I think, you know, as you're growing up, somehow you have to be smaller, which is just crazy. But I think that relates to so many women on so many different levels.
I mean, the male characters are really interesting in this as well. Obviously, they're all played by the women. But I was thinking out how it's the death of the male figures that predominantly make these massive sweeping changes in her life. So when her father dies at the very top of the play, she ends up taken away age 8 to Susan Bertie to become a lady in court. And then when her lover, Lord Carey, dies, she was his mistress, her life gets turned upside down again and she hasn't got any financial support then coming in. And then her husband kills himself, and then she ends up being, you know, the other side of the river, teaching to these women. And it's all of the male deaths have this massive sweeping effect on her, whereas when her mother dies, it's literally just her kind of a hand in the crowd. You can see her face and then she's gone, and then there's just the line of, oh, and my mother died, essentially.
Yeah, which kind of reflects, completely reflects society, doesn't it? Particularly in that time, but to a certain extent now, because I think because the men hold the power, right? And certainly did then. And I think because, you know, that money got passed down the male line and not down the female line. So actually, particularly in those times, a woman dying or your mother dying had very little influence on your life. It had very little impact in terms of financial, or whatever happened with you in your house would not change. But your father died, and that would be a huge change in shift in your life, in your entire life. Whether you were allowed to stay at home or whether that house would get passed to someone else. So I think that massive injustice that her life has to be so balanced with a man. So I think that's why it has such an impact. And it does on stage as well. Like, it has quite a big, it's almost like, oh no, okay, that's happened because a man died. I now have to shift and change my life because of that.
I think it's quite nice how it kind of brings you back to that time as well, because the characters are, in themselves, they're quite like modern characters. The language is quite modern. You know, it's got this like funky vibe to it. You could kind of sometimes forget that actually that was the world that they lived in, and that was how it was. So just drop feeding stuff like that all the way through just consistently reminds you of that.
I love that balance of language in the play. I love the fact that it goes from modern to kind of Elizabethan so effortlessly and so quickly as well. And it's just brilliant how it's written. And it kind of makes you kind of sit upright occasionally, because you're kind of listening to this Elizabethan sort of scripture, and you're like, okay, yeah, I'm listening to these Elizabethan phrases and words and meter. And then suddenly, like a big, massive full stop in your face, she comes in with like these really modern things, and it's great and makes it's just brilliant for the comedy. But also, I think, really importantly, reminds us whatever her journey was then is still our journey now as well. And I think that relationship with what she's trying to say and how she uses the language to do that is magnificent.
I think this is one of my favourite bits. Can we read it, Meg? Can we read it? Yay! So this is from page 25. So this is when Emilia meets Shakespeare, almost for the first time. They've passed across briefly before, and it's where they set up this relationship, essentially, that he's her almost her equal in terms of her wit and her cleverness and...
Battle of wits.
I'll read Shakespeare, you read Emilia?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay. You're so angry. Why? You're like a trapped wasp.
All right. We're doing this, are we?
Doing what?
You know what. Fine, let's do it. If I'm a wasp, best beware my sting.
If you sting me, I'll pluck it out.
Aye, if you can find it.
Well, who doesn't know where a wasp keeps his sting? It's in his tail.
In his tongue.
Whose tongue?
Your tongue, if you don't leave me be.
Is this... I mean, are we... I don't know what this is. I guess that brilliant, like, how she punctuates that comedy by just putting that kind of really modern expression with this. What are we... I'm sorry, what are we doing here? I don't know.
Shakespeare's never come across a woman who's, like, who's given it back as equally... He's like, whoa, what is this? I like this, yeah. But what is it?
And do you know what's great? I love about that is that also obviously is taken from Taming of the Shrew. And
yeah.
What's great is I think if you don't know that as an audience member, you don't know where that's from. That's cool. That's fine.
I didn't.
It's just, did you not?
I'm terrible, all right. It's Meg's the Shakespeare buff.
It is the first Kate and Petruchio meeting. And if you don't know where that's from, that's cool. You just think this is some sort of like banter between these two, yeah. And that's amusing enough. But actually... underneath that is really clever for the Shakespeare buffs in the audience. It keeps them entertained as well, and going, ah, and you can feel quite smug. I felt very smug sitting there in the audience when I read that. I was like, oh, I know everybody. I know where that's from. I know what play.
It's so important, though, isn't it, to have it working on those two levels?
Well, yeah, I think, and also because it was obviously, it is the main attraction of it initially was that it was at the Globe, and so therefore was focusing on Shakespeare. So, it, you know, you're going to get the Shakespeare buffs and the Shakespeare fans coming along to see it. So I think that's really important that correlation and that reminder about Shakespeare is there. It's just presenting him in a whole new way.
Yeah, like he's hardly in the play at all, is he? Mm. Which is quite nice. It's like, he's there, but meh.
It's not his story today.
Not his story. Her story.
But she sets him up so interestingly, though, I think, and setting him up as being this equal to Emilia, who by now is, you know, she enters through the audience at the top of the play. We're on her side. She is our heroine, and we love her from off. Morgan Lloyd Malcolm sets him up to be kind of like an equal for her, and, you know, someone who's worthy of her because he gets her wit and he can banter with her and flirt. And I think that's really important that we are allowed to see him like that before then later on in the play the fame all kind of goes to his head and the praise, and he becomes a bit of a douche who refers to the Globe as my gaff.
I'm definitely going to start using that.
And he starts stealing her words and, you know, and taking credit for stuff. But at this moment in time, as a British audience, we're like, no, it's Shakespeare. We can't rag on Shakespeare because he's our dude. We have to have ownership of him. So introducing him as a character who's really palatable and we root for him, and you're like, oh no, don't be a dick, Shakespeare.
Yeah, and Lexie, how important is that message, though? Because almost every woman I know has had an idea or something stolen at some point. And even if, you know, like couples, for instance, how many times have you heard the wife going, I literally said that. I said that this morning. I said we should leave at 7 o'clock, not you. Yeah, I think we've all had our ideas stolen. And certainly as a creative, I've definitely had those stolen by companies I've worked with and by the men at the top who've then gone, oh, this is a brilliant idea. And you're like, oh, my God. Actually said this about 2 or 3 weeks ago or a year ago, and I had this conversation with you and now you are projecting it as your own. And we sit down, we let that happen, and I've let that happen a lot because I've thought, well, at least I'm getting my own way and we're kind of, this is happening now, which I think it should. But I, you know, I think that is so important that we see such an immense character like Shakespeare, such an immense historical figure that, like you say, Lexie, we're so passionate about, and he's so important to the British culture, that we see even him taking a woman's ideas, even somebody so phenomenal, so creative, so imaginative, so talented as Shakespeare has actually also, potentially, we don't know, stolen some ideas. But do you know what? Even if he did or he didn't, the point is there, isn't it? And that's what Morgan has done so well, is made that point that actually even the people you think are even the best creative people could still take an idea off a woman.
It's more like, it's not about whether he did or not, is it? It's about him being that type of person and reflecting that.
It kind of represents a lot of men, doesn't it? He kind of, as Emilia, represents women as a whole. I think in a way there is something about the fact that Shakespeare also represents a lot of men as well. And I think also what she cleverly does is, rather than make him look like a douche, as you said, Lexie, straight away, you know, he's quite endearing to start with, isn't he? He's quite bumbly and a bit idiotic.
Yeah, we root for him.
Yeah, like he is every rom-com terrible first
Hugh
date
Grant.
Guy.
He is a Hugh Grant from the 90s. He is Notting Hill. He is... I can't think of another one.
No, Four Weddings and a Funeral. That's who he is.
Four Weddings and a Funeral. The orange juice. Shakespeare is orange juice on a shirt, standing in front of a girl asking him to love her, damn it.
He is.
Oh my God.
That's what he is. It's true. And that idiot we always love. We don't want the big heroic guy, do we? We like the bumbling idiot in the rom-coms. British love that guy. We love the guy who's a bit, you know, he isn't suave and who isn't, you know, doesn't come in. We like the idiot who kind of makes loads of mistakes. And that's what Shakespeare does, that he's quite intimidated by her initially, which I think is fab. And it's so well portrayed. But then he gets this kind of power with the globe, with his gaff. And then suddenly he's he thinks himself superior to her in a way.
You really root for their relationship at the beginning, don't you? And I thought, oh, the play is going to explore the relationship between them, but it didn't. And I'm so glad it didn't, because that shouldn't be what her story is.
No, for sure, because we've always heard how a woman's story relates to a man, right? And how it relates to that romantic relationship in some way. So it's great that, yes, it was there and it's really important, but that wasn't her full story.
No, like, look at all these other amazing things she did.
And all of her kind of her big up moments, I'm going to steal that term, is like having her girls around her. So this connection she has with the women she teaches are from the south of the river.
I love them.
Yeah, it's squad goals, isn't it?
Do you know what I like about the women from the south of the river? Is that though they're the working class women, they're not portrayed as dumb, idiotic, stupid people. And I think that is how the working class are portrayed so much on stage. And they're always sent up as being the really stupid ones. And I love that there's something, you know, they're not educated, and there's nothing disguised about that. No, they're not educated. But the fact that they're there to get educated from Emilia, they take the step to do that. But they're so genuine, and they're so kind, and they're so lovely, and completely different to the women at court, because the women at court are really actually quite horrible to her. You know, they're all kind of competing with each other.
It's a sense of... the ones in core, they're there for themselves. They're quite selfish, whereas the girls south of the river, I quite like how you said that. And they're like, they're girls, aren't they? They're supporting her. They drag her out of the river.
Yeah, and they actually support her feminism at a sort of root a lot more than the women at court do, because they just, you know, they're always saying to her to stop writing. And I think one of them at one point says, stop writing the poems. And the other one says, no, let her do it, because it's less competition for us at court. The more she writes like a man, the more that they dislike us. So we've got less competition, which is, let that settle in. And how, and you know, there are women who bring down other women, but there also are women who support other women, and that's when things really start to get interesting.
Yeah, there's one bit in particular that I absolutely love. It's so she's teaching them how to write poems, and one character, Eve, who's definitely my favourite, she says, oh, I've written this poem inspired by your writings, by your teaching. So we get Eve, all right, here we go, be kind. Where are you going, you horrible bastard? You owe me a coin for that trick. Don't you run from me if you know what's good for you. I'll make a tree of you with this stick. I don't care how much you hit me. My husband does it so much I'm blue. But if you take my coin, I'll kill you. That's just what girls gotta do. Thank you. The women applaud and cheer. Emilia, my goodness, you were inspired by my poem to write that. Eve, well, look, you talk of making sure you've always have ways of keeping valuable things to yourself, like jewels and clothes, so your husband can't spend everything you own, which is canny and good advice. Except I ain't never had no jewels, and the only clothes I own are the ones I'm wearing, and I ain't no one paying me nothing for these old shitty rags, so I thought to myself, what's the equivalent? Mary, ooh, girl. Hester, equivalent. Eve, yeah, I went there, new word. Amelia, well done for using it correctly. And I don't know why, I just absolutely love that bit. I think it's because of the whole equivalent ooh girl sort of thing. I think it's so good. And if I was in the audience watching,
yeah, and you know, it feels like a modern conversation. You're watching something that feels genuinely like it could be an Elizabethan thing that could have happened.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you're sitting there and it sounds like sitting around with your own girlfriends, right? You're sitting around going, ooh, look at you using the posh word.
Yeah. Which obviously would have happened. Like, you always get people always like, well, did they actually talk like Shakespeare? And you're like, oh, well, that's a complicated question. But,
Yeah, and it's really important, I think, the way that Morgan does that is that, you know, using that, like I said before, that Elizabethan, but then kind of merging that with the modern day text to remind us this is still women now. This is like, it makes you part of it, makes you feel part of that journey and that relationship with them, which is just fab.
And bless Eve as a character as well, because we really fall for her and her journey, and then they burn her on a stake. They found her with the pamphlets for the work, you know, trying to put about the work that Emilia was putting out. They said it was the devil's work, and we see Eve being placed on a pyre, music, build, horror and sadness, and Emilia 3, when we do not stay silent, this is what they do, this is what they did, our Eve... They took our Eve, and while she speaks, we see Eve go up in flames. Yeah, a character you just really fall for. And then, I mean, that's a challenge and a half, isn't it? Let's just burn the actress on a pyre, why not? That's an easy stage direction to fulfill.
Get in the pyros. But you know what? When I saw it in the West End, I don't remember there being, and I'm not saying there isn't before anybody shoots me down about this, but I don't remember there being any pyros or anything like that. I remember there being smoke.
There was an emotional fire in your soul.
How so? Very, very eloquently put, Lexie. Yes, indeed.
That's me.
It doesn't need to be showy if the feeling's there.
Yeah, yeah, I think that's the thing.
We know what happens, do you know what I mean? It's not a new thing, we know what happens.
Yeah, like they didn't, I like the fact that they didn't go for all the, you know, sparkle that theatre can have, because actually what was mainly important was the emotion, and that's the bit that sticks in my head, was the sadness that you kind of felt and the sort of panic going, oh no, it can't be her. That's the bit that really sticks in my head, that memory, and not the memory of the visuals. Because actually, I think if it was visually like, ooh, big smoke, wow, you'd go, oh yeah, there's this really cool effect where they burnt a woman, but they didn't actually burn the woman. And not remembering actually the emotional tone of it. So well done to the director on that point.
And the emotional moments in it are so poignant. I mean, each time the Emilia goes into the next phase of Emilianess, so when Emilia 1 transitions to Emilia 2 to transition to Emilia 3, there's this big moment within it which is so sad. So for Emilia 1, it's the discovering her baby girl has died, and you see her with the child coming to that realisation in that text, and her literally being kind of collapsing and being carried off. And then with Emilia 2, it's after some men have mistaken her for a woman who might sell her body, and are saying, you know, she didn't, they, you know, they deserve to have it, essentially. And she's had this massive cathartic fight, and she pummels the shit out of them. Whoop! And the men run off, and she's kind of overwhelmed and enveloped by her squad of girls from the south of the river, and again taken off. And each time, it's like the new Emilia is born out, like a phoenix out of the ashes of these really terrible, tragic moments of the other one's life, just getting stronger and stronger and rising back up again.
But that's what happens, isn't it? That's, you know, that's the reality of what happens, and it's really nice to see it reflected in the play. And other than it giving the three actors the chance to play the part as well, it just amplifies that.
And those stages in your life, I think that's what I liked about the fact that they were played by different actors, because it, like you say, it emphasizes those moments. And I think, you know, most of us, once you get to a sort of certain age in life, you can pinpoint these really big moments in your life and you go, actually, that was a massive day in my life and that made me be a slightly different person after that, which I think that isn't just a, you know, obviously it is a woman's journey, but I think that isn't just a woman's journey. I think, you know, a lot of people have experienced something where they go, after that, something changed in me and I wasn't quite the same person as I was before. So that's lovely that it's actually physically represented and so clever, because actually you're not quite the same person. It's not quite the same person you're seeing on stage. You are seeing another woman, but not quite the same. Visually, she doesn't look quite the same. And I think that's so cleverly done.
Mm.
It did make me wonder, like, why hasn't that been done before? Yeah. Like, why haven't I seen that? Being like, that's just, it seems like such an obviously great thing to do.
Yeah, because people often do it as an age thing, don't they? You know, sometimes you see it in plays of like, oh, it's, this is her, like, they often do it with Jane Eyre, for instance, don't they? Jane Eyre is often played by a younger actor and then going to a slightly older actor for her older years. But to actually do it because we're trying to make a point of this woman wasn't quite the same after this point. This character had a life-altering moment and wasn't quite the same person, so let's not have quite the same person on stage, which is brilliant.
And the three of them when they have lines together or on stage together is just a really powerful visual and image. And let's talk, if we're talking powerful visuals, let's talk about that last speech.
Oh my goodness.
Oh, what a blooming cry to arms. So it's at the very end of the play, it comes near the end of, after Eve's death, and Shakespeare's come back tell Emilia after he's died that, you know, when things started to shift, you knew you would emerge, but you would be able to give something hundreds of years after you died. And she was like, she's like, yep, clever. And he says, clever woman. Yeah, I am. And then she takes a moment and she just talks directly to the audience. So the stage's review, J.M. Benjamin said, the open architecture of the space of the globe gave the speech a feeling of limitless, of freedom. And as Claire Perkin spoke, there was a sense that her words could be heard for miles around. It's just a tribal call, isn't it?
I love tribal.
Perfect analogy to it. Because it does, when you're in the audience and you're, I mean, it has quite a lot of impact, I think, when you read it. But when you see it, and the way that Claire performed it as well was just absolutely incredible. But yeah, it does. It feels like there was like a fervour in the audience, which it was so exciting. It was electric by the end. And as she was talking, like, women were whooping and making noises and stuff. And I haven't seen that other than, you know, music concerts or, you know, or sometimes at musicals, but that's in a different way. This was emotional. This was driven from a feeling connected to the play, which is just incredible.
Like it was Beyonce on the stage or something. Like, that's the same reaction.
It is Lemonade.
Emilia is Lemonade.
I'm just going to read this last little bit of it. So it's underscored as in this text. It says, a rumble is approaching. So this is underscored with drums. Listen to us. Listen to every woman who came before you. Listen to every woman with you now. And listen when I say to you to take the fire as your own. That anger you feel, it is yours and you can use it. We want you to. We need you to. Look how far we've come already. Don't stop now. The house that has been built around you is not made of stone. The stakes we have been tied to will not survive if our flames burn bright. And if they try to burn you, may your fire be stronger than theirs so you can burn the whole fucking house down. I mean, that could be my favourite end to a play I think I've actually read ever. It's so... even just reading that last little bit just makes you go...
It's like you'd hold in your breath the whole time. I was like... And then after, you're like...
I'm very difficult to please when it comes to having a standing ovation. And I'm a bit funny about giving a standing ovation. And I get very annoyed in the West End during musicals where it's an automatic thing to give a friggin' standing ovation. It's like, oh, somebody's finished singing. Let's all stand up and clap our hands. I'm like, no. A standing ovation should be because it's one of the best things you've seen in your life. So I do get very animated about this and very passionate about it. But for me, the end of Emilia, you were standing without even knowing it. As she was talking, you were just going, yes, 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 I agree. Oh my goodness, yes. And there were women kind of whooping and kind of clapping already in the middle of the speech. And then she got to the end, and before you knew it, you were kind of just standing up and clapping because you just felt so moved and passionate about it. And it just, oh, it's just, it kind of, it was like grappling hooks going into your soul and pulling you up out the seat. That's what it felt like at the end. And the fact that all three of them were on the stage and they were holding hands, and, you know, it did feel like, come on, girls, we understand, we get this, but let's be in this together. Let's be the women from south of the river. Let's, you know, let's all be, let's keep moving forward and keep pushing, because, you know, like Shakespeare says to her, although what you do today might not have a difference today, but it might have a difference in 100 years time, or 200 years time, or 400 years time. And I think that is such a huge message by holding hands with these women, going, look, you know, your efforts might not make out to be much right now, and they weren't for her, but didn't seem to be, but now they have made a huge difference, because her story was being told on stage, and however many hundred women that were in that audience were going, yes, oh my goodness, I feel it, yes, which is incredible. And also, I think, also, let's think about the words clever girl and clever woman that's used throughout the play, because you never call a man, oh, clever man, clever lad, clever man.
And I love how when they say, oh, you're a clever woman, she just goes, yeah, thanks.
It also has a patronising sort of quality to it, doesn't it? To go, clever man. You'd never go.
Yeah, exactly.
You'd never go, clever man, would you? Like, you would never say that, but, you know, oh, clever girl, clever woman. Because it's like almost it's surprising that it's a woman that's being clever. And that is used so often throughout the play. And it really stuck with me as well, those two words, as much as the ending did, which is just the most incredible ending.
Well, I think we have to end there with our incredible ending after talking about that incredible ending. And the clever woman that is Emilia, and that is Morgan Lloyd Malcolm, and everyone involved in this show, and both of you guys. Thank you, my clever women, and I don't mean that patronisingly, for joining us today. Ah, that was so cool to talk with Beck about Emilia. She clearly is a powerhouse, passionate play person. I started trying to make that really alliterative and fail.
It was great having her on as well, because she's seen it live. I think it was nice to have that extra level to it.
Yeah, and also to make us just exceedingly jealous.
Yeah, very, very, very jealous.
But what a play to end the series on.
I knew that one had to be the last one. I was like, this is going to be good. It's going to be feminist. It's how we need to go out with a bang, like they did.
Yeah, well, like they say, they end with a song, a dance and a celebration after they burn the house down. So
I want to go back in time, Lexi, and see it live. Like, it actually makes me sad.
But that's it, guys. That wraps up season one of Script in Hand. And I've loved doing it with you. It's been so much fun. And also just a brilliant way to keep us creative during lockdown, and hopefully our listeners have been able to get a bit of that as well,
and how to broaden knowledge as well. I feel a lot more intelligent than I did when we started this, just from reading these texts, so thank you to everyone who has written a play.
There's definite plays in here that I don't think I would have picked up were we not doing this and going, you know, what's going to make a good balance to the season, what are we interested in? There's one, and I'm so glad we have, and my knowledge is definitely richer for it. And so thank you so much to all of our listeners. It's amazing getting to see where people listen from. Like, we have listeners in America and South America, and I get really excited seeing where people and across Europe where people are listening in from. It's an absolute joy. So please do tell your friends. They've got an entire back catalogue of season one to listen to now before we come back before the end of the year with season two. We're thinking autumn, winter time. We haven't put a date on it. We're totally cast.
Keeping it loose, keeping it free.
but in the meantime, before now and then, we will pop up and do a couple of specials. Yeah. We've got a few things we want to talk about with you, including next week. We're going to do kind of a summing up of season one, a roundup of all 12 plays we've talked about, looking back of which ones, now we've read them all, you know, which ones, as Meg might say, which ones would we wish we could try and travel to go see it, like an original cast of, or which would we recommend? So we're going to have a little bit of a fun season roundup. Grab the popcorn, put on the face masks, get in your slippers. I don't know where this analogy is going again.
I don't know, but I like it.
Thank you. We'll do it.
It's going to be hard because I feel like I genuinely recommend and like them all. So it'll be... I'm going to have to think about these questions properly for a week, sit on it and come back with some better answers than read them all.
Yeah, we'll try and be more specific. Mm. Thank you, Meg. It has been a bloody pleasure.
Thank you, Lexie.
So, as always, you can find us on social media. We are at Script in Hand Pod. We are on the Twitter. We are on the Instagram. We are on the Facebook. And we will be there throughout, you know, down during this downtime. We will still recommend plays. We'll be posting things. Do give us a like, give us a follow, subscribe, give us a share, give us a review now you've held the whole series, assuming you've made it this far, you haven't just decided to start on episode 12 for no real reason. Let us know what you thought. We would love to hear from you.
We love getting Twitter mentions, don't we?
Yeah. Please tell us over the next week, what's within your favourite play we've talked about, or maybe episode? Have you gone and bought any of the plays on the back of an episode? Or have you thought we've been talking garbage and we really should not be allowed anywhere near a microphone again? Get in touch. Let us know, please. That would be amazing. You can find me at LexieW99 on Twitter.
And I'm at MegRobinson94.
And as always, one final time this series, big up to Connor Barton for the amazing sound and music. So, as we sign off for the final time this series, with a stage direction from Emilio, it has to be the final stage direction from the play.
A song, a dance, a celebration. See you next series. Oh!